ECMO circuit complication. In this lecture, I will go for complication of the circuit itself, the machine itself, and its of component. I will divide the complications into two parts. This is the first part of complication. As we mentioned before, ECMO circuit is a closed circuit. It is start and end by the patient. So, as we can see in the video, it's continuous flow. There is no pulse as like original heart. So, every part in this circuit will have its complication. The cannula, the pump, oxygenator, and the console, the heat exchanger, every part will have its complication. Complication related to the circuit, the first thing is pump-related complication, and the first thing in it is hemolysis, which appearance of free hemoglobin in blood plasma in concentration more than 50 mg per deciliter. Why hemolysis will occur? If there is extreme negative pressure generated by the pump, like inadequate venous drainage, intermittent venous line shattering, for example, hypovolemia, high shear stress with appearance of turbulent flow. Also, hemolysis can occur with the ruler pump more than centrifugal pump. And for example, if we see patient who has a bypass cardiac surgery and stay on bypass for about 12 hours, he will come with hemolysis. However, patient can stay weeks on ECMO if proper management without any hemolysis. How to diagnose hemolysis? Like we will first do lab work if hemolysis work up, like leukocytic count, LDH, total bilirubin, and undirect bilirubin. Then we will check ECMO control, speed of the pump, and the negative pressure. Check the circuit for presence of clots or thrombus, shattering in the circuit, for example, like movement in the venous line. We will explain it later. This is because of hypovolemia. We can treat the cause, and if the cause is pump thrombosis, we can change the circuit. And this picture, this is a picture of a real patient from my unit. And we, in that patient, there is a thrombosis in the oxygenator. And at that time, we change the circuit. The second part of pump-related complication is cavitation and excessive negative pressure. And as I mentioned before in the third lecture, which is named ECMO circuit monitoring, that there are three pressures inside the ECMO circuit, P1, P2, P3. Now, the most important is P1, which is pre-pump pressure, and it is negative pressure. In pre-pump pressure, it shouldn't exceed minus 100 millimeter mercury. And if there is extreme high negative pressure plus interruption in venous drainage, so that will create more negative pressure, which minus 750 millimeter mercury. When the dissolved gas will come out of the solution, this will happen if the atmospheric pressure will be less than the negative pressure. So this gas will causing lysis of RBCs and the release of free hemoglobin. So sudden interruption in the blood flow and the pump rotate at high speed. So the pump eject the blood with no volume to refill the space. That will mean cavitation. So that will create gaseous microemboli. To treat this condition, we should slow the speed and give fluid to replace the volume. The third part of pump-related complication is thrombosis. Older generation of centrifugal pump had thrombus are due to heat around fixed shaft. It's now better. Also, it may occur if inadequate pump head washout, as blood will retain inside the pump head. Some small thrombus can aspirate by the pump from a venous side and enlarge inside the pump. And both of them can lead to hemolysis or pump failure. These are two pictures of different pump thrombosis. This occurred in my unit. And one of them represented with complete pump failure and the other was represented by hemolysis in the circuit. Fourth part of pump-related complication is pump failure. Maybe motor failure or pump flow sensor failure, EC power failure, or pump head disengagement. Pump failure is the most important complication related to the circuit. It can occur in all magnetic driven centrifugal pump when there is impeller imbalance within the head. Maybe due to magnetic field disturbance, air entry, or small clots which disturb the head balance. This can be represented with noise, hemolysis, and the pump will stop suddenly. So at that time, we can use hand crank to maintain flow till we connect the circuit. Another form of pump failure is power failure. We should know that pump battery life can at least last for 1 hour for full operation. The pump should alarm when low flow or there is a reverse flow, the flow come from the arterial side, or if there is pump failure. At that time, we can use hand cranks manually to adjust the flow. If we have the console and it is not in use, it should be plugged in to decrease this power failure. How to manage electrical motor failure? First, we clamp the line, turn off the pump, and if we have the cause not clear for us, we can use hand crank till we had new console, and by using hand crank we will should remove the clamps and achieve the flow manually. After solving the issue and return back the pump to the new console, we will turn on the speed to 1000 rpm, then removing the clamp, increase the ramp gradually. The second thing, how to manage pump failure. Clamp the line, also turn off the pump. If we are on VA ECMO, we can maximize the anitropes and ventilatory support. If we are on VV ECMO, we can maximize ventilatory setting. Can change the circuit and fix it well. Turn on the pump to speed 1000 rpm, removing the clamp, and we can increase the ramp gradually. In this video, this is a life change of the circuit. This is a VA ECMO patient who has oxygenator thrombus. So now we will change the circuit. This is circuit after priming, and we prepare everything from the patient side before we will go to the console to decrease the speed. Ensure there is no airing and clamp the line from our side. Also to ensure there's no air. Now we go for the console and decrease the speed of the pump to 500 rpm. After reaching the speed to 500 rpm, the perfusionist will clamp the line, the boost lines from his side, and we will now everything the ECMO is stopped. So from the patient side, we try to connect the new one and remove the old one. Now, if we can see, he clamped even the cannula from the patient side to avoid air entering during a change. After he ensure everything, he removed the clamp. He will do that in the other side. Then after everything is okay, we will move the clamp, another clamp from the patient side, go for console, increase RPM to 1000, and then remove the clamp, starting ECMO smoothly. Another part of ECMO-related complication is the circuit itself complication, and one of the most life-threatening complication, if it's happened, it's air embolism. If presence of air inside the circuit is detected, we should clamp the return line at that part. This is a schematic diagram for ECMO circuit, and here there is pre-oxygenator air. And if we have pre-oxygenator air, we should thinking about there is improper priming, leak or cracking inside the circuit and the connections, loose connection between the venous cannula and the circuit tubes, dislodged or malposition on the venous cannula. So at the time, we should check venous line and make sure that's no air and reset the bubble detector if it's a very small amount. If the air present in the venous line, we should assess very well if the air didn't pass the bubble detector, and we can aspirate the air here from the pre-oxygenator level, it's a small amount, and do de-airing through the oxygenator. The most dangerous effect of air embolism if it is post-oxygenator. If this happens, this is maybe due to tear or crackles inside the membrane itself. There is this connection between the cannula and return cannula and the circuit. At that time, as we said before, first clamp the line, the return line, to avoid the air to go to the patient. After that, if the air is still inside the oxygenator, we can aspirate the air through post-oxygenator port here. If the air inside post-oxygenator or come out from the post-oxygenator, we can clamp the line, do the Trendberg position to the patient, and we can remove the air if it is a small amount and still near the oxygenator through the airing port of the post-oxygenator. If we can do that, we can go for a change of the circuit at that time. In this picture, we can see two ports. This is a pre-oxygenator, and that is post-oxygenator. From that side, we can aspirate blood, and we try to make the airing. If there is some air, it can come with the blood, and from this side also, a post-oxygenator part. This demo for how we can aspirate air from pre-oxygenator side. This done during priming of the circuit, and also can we can do it during ECMO running. And here we aspirate air from post-oxygenator side. Another circuit related complication, which is serious but it's rare, tube rupturing. It can occur due to damage or crack in earthway, which can be under wheel or kinked. So as to prevent that complication, we should take care of tubes not to be under wheels. Also, to prevent the serious complication to happen, the clamps should put beside the circuit as this complication happens suddenly. If we had this complication, we should maximize the ventilation, hemodynamics, remove the patient from the ECMO, and change the damaging section, or maybe can go for changing the circuit. When we should change the circuit? If we have leakage in the circuit, air penetration in the circuit, visible deposit in the sets of the tubes in the circuit, presence of circuit rupture, or presence of pump thrombosis. Sometimes if we have problem in the oxygenator, like increase in pressure drop, insufficient oxygenation, or CO2 removal at maximum sweep gas, or FiO2 100%, increase the pressure difference, or impaired gas exchange, all of these reflect a problem in oxygenator. In some types, we can change only the oxygenator, or in sometimes, like cardio help, we should change the whole circuit. Another circuit-related complication, heat exchange-related complication, we should suspect that in two conditions, if we have blood or protein are present in circulating water, or presence of unexplained hemolysis, like water-to-blood heat exchange leak suspected. How to test the efficacy of heat exchange? We can detect membrane oxygenator heat exchanger failure by taking blood gas of the circuit blood priming. We will find hypochlorite. Also, we can observe the attached manometer which is present inside the pressurized water chamber for any fall in pressure inside the heat exchange. Heat exchange alarm showed two differences in temperature. This for the machine, and this is from the patient. The difference between them should both of them should be adjusted to be equal to each other. At the end of this lecture, I should thank my colleagues Nada and Maisa for their help to take images and videos of this lecture. Besides the reference mentioned in here, also I depend on Elso Redbook. Thanks, and you can post your questions in the comments.